Okay, Kala, to answer both your questions, hopefully, what you are saying about this person who has a disability not being able to achieve moksha, the thing is that it is a bigger hurdle for him. Already, we ourselves have our own hurdles. It's not as if our path is, you know, very smooth. We have our own ignorance. We have our own shortcomings, weaknesses, which we have to overpower to continue on this path. For example, none of us are in a position right now to take sannyas. That is the, or vanaprastha even for that matter. So that is our first weakness. Now, if you take a person who has a real disability, who doesn't have eyes or doesn't have ears, for that person, it becomes an even bigger difficulty. With all our whole body, even if we started in childhood, maybe the we might, at the end of this birth, if our sanskaras were good enough, which we brought in into this janma, maybe we will reach moksha. But maybe we may not, even though we tried since childhood. We made progress on the path, but we may not achieve the ultimate goal. For a person who has this disability, it becomes almost close to impossible. But as we have seen, nothing is impossible. And if a person really puts in wholehearted effort and there is no leakage of effort into anything else, sure, something may happen. Yeah. And, what was the other question which you had? Other problem?
You complete the prescribed duties of each ashrama.
Yeah, and yeah. Then... So this that is on a daily basis. It is not on a lifetime basis. Yeah. Oh, otherwise, like you are saying, it will never be complete. Till we die, there is some duty which is there to perform. So that is not the one. It is on a daily basis. You while you are within this ashrama, then if when you decide that okay, it is time for me, for example, to take vanaprastha, and you want to reduce your interactions with general people, at that time you hand over your responsibilities properly to whoever, your next generation or to your trustees or whoever it is. You have to hand over your responsibilities properly and give it up. So that is part of your responsibility itself.
Okay, it's not one cut. It's a gradual thing. Yeah, okay,
yeah, ideally, it is a gradual thing. You see in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, there is a place where Yajnavalkya calls his two wives and Maitreyi and Gargi. Maitreyi and non-Gargi. Katyayani. So he calls Maitreyi and Katyayani and he says that now I want to take sannyas. So you please distribute between yourselves. Let me finish the matter with you. So that is how the Upanishad starts actually. So this is how ideally it should be done, but not suddenly just go away.
Okay.
So, is that a good Upanishad to do?
Brihadaranyaka, yeah, definitely, definitely. It's a very huge.
So, are we doing that next?
Actually, I was thinking of doing Prashna. If you are asking this question, I was thinking of taking up Prashna Upanishad next.
Okay, whatever you think is better for us, no problem.
Yeah, that will be a slightly shorter one and we can finish it off quickly. This has been a very long innings. So, I will be taking a long break, but after that, we can have a shorter innings.
No, you separately, you have the Prashnottar Upanishad, is it?
Prashnopanishad.
Oh,
Prashna. Yeah, only Prashna.
Okay. All the questions are in that.
No, not all the questions. It is about six questions which some brahmacharis have. So then how the guru answers those questions.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. And which is the one where that Nachiketa asked the question?
That is Kata.
Kata. Yeah. Kata Upanishad.
Kathopanishad, yeah, okay, that's the one. So you're not taking the Kathopanishad right now?
Kathopanishad I have covered, and it is there in my book also, Smokeless Fire, you can read it there.
Oh, okay.
Okay, who's going next?
Shall we take it?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Let me first thank you, Uttara, for involving us and including us in the class. No, really thankful to you. And not only that, it is nice to know the group of six people. And they were really so, what to say, they were really...
She knows so Chandran very well.
Right.
Every week you made it a point to everyone has to come and recap the chapters. That was another good point. And the third point, I would like to say that thing, you were absolutely dot to the punctual. And you start at 2, and that punctuality, I really appreciated that very much. And for any student of philosophy, must know the Anushasan is very important too. And which you have, from your example, you have showed it that. Coming to the point about the Sankhya Darshana, we, as you always used to say, that we are all in the southern part of India, so most of us, we have that Shankara's Advaita. It became a... It took a long time for us to get away from the Maya and think, or not to think about the Advaita and think about the Trivaida. So because Kapila always believed in that Purusha, Prakriti and Jivatma, all three are separate. They are not together. And Kapila started the first chapter where he talks about all his the Sankhya is developed. So in that he says the basic thing is we all have to get out of the if we have to get the moksha, we need to get out of all the Trivida, which Kala has already recapped. No, not Kala. She did it. Shrividya. Vidya did it. So she has already said that about the Trividya, Trivida Dukha, Adhyatmik, Adi Daivik, and Adi Bhautik, we have to get over. For that, for this, keeping this at the crutch of the whole Sankhya, and he has woven around everything around that. How to get the moksha. For that, not to have the dukkha till the end. So, and he starts the how the creation started, but he never said from where the jivatma or from the purusha came, we don't know. But he says the prakriti came into contact with the purusha, and purusha instigated something, and then the creation started.
Those are two purushas. So in Sankhya, only one purusha is actually covered, and that is the soul. And Ishvara is mentioned as Ishvara. So don't confuse the two purushas as far as this text is concerned.
No, the purusha is the one I know. But what about the jivatma?
Jivatma is purusha, and God is Ishvara.
Okay, so but the thing is, then how all the thing when Sat, Rajas, and Tamas, all of them are in equilibrium, what is that makes it to because God. Imbalance?
God.
Which God?
One God.
Is it Ishvara?
Ishvara.
Okay, that's what I want to say. Okay.
Yeah.
Ishvara is the one, he comes into contact or something like that, he creates some imbalance in that.
That is part of his karma. He starts creation by, you can say, stirring the cauldron. Cauldron is sitting over there with all the juices lying in equilibrium. And now he stirs it up, puts the fire under it, and suddenly things start coming out of the cauldron. Look upon it that way. So he is the guy who starts off creation. Now everything starts coming out of it. You have galaxies coming out, hydrogen, helium, etc., etc. Stars start forming, and then planets come. Planets now can have life. Now God again connects the soul, that is Jivatma, with matter. That is also part of his work. That is his karma. Karma as is not the karma which has phala, but a kriya, let us say. That is his job.
But from where? No, but what about the Jivatma? From where the Jivatma has come?
Jivatma is the other eternity. There is a trinity which is eternal. One God, too many souls, and one matter.
No, I asked the question also to you. So this book also, they have not shown where exactly the Jivatma and Ishvara.
So in that I answered to, in fact, Mr. Chandran also, he had the same question and had already answered before. In the first chapter, when he has listed the various tattvas, in the order in which they come, in the end of it, he says Purusha, because Purusha exists on its own. It does not get generated out of matter. It already exists.
Okay.
So these 25 elements together, they form the universe.
Yeah, the 25 elements. Yeah, correct there. That's what
so
they
then say. If you read the 25 element, the 25th is Purusha, which is not himself. It is the soul. It is Jivatma.
It's a Jivatma.
Yeah. Actually, you and Mr. Chandran have made that same mistake while reading, that you are assuming Purusha is God, Purusha is God. But in my explanation, I have written soul.
Oh no, I don't know that thing. I have not read his explanation, because I have said it differently. And
See, one 26th sutra which is there, after he says, sattva rajasa tamasam etc samyavastha sthula bhutani purusha iti pancha vinshatir ganaha. What is this gana? This is the gana which makes up the universe.
Okay.
So,
God
is part of this universe. He is in this universe, but he is not part of it, in the sense that he is not conjoined to anything in any way. We have that synaptic connection with matter, but God, he doesn't even have that.
Okay. Anyhow, I have to go back and reread how many times, I don't know, but I have to do that thing. And a couple of things which I liked it in that fourth chapter, where he uses all the stories through that, he tells how the moksha can be get it. So in that, the Indra and Virochana, the story is very interesting, which is really sticking to my mind. And another in the last chapter, where he says the Ahankara is the reason for the Abhiveka, but his student and his great student, that Panchashikha and that Sadananda, they do differ a little bit, but still Kapila says, okay, I do accept that these are the efficient cause and the causal body, they are the one for the Abhiveka, in not the Ahankaras, that's the thing. And another thing is that three Pramanas are very important of his Shabda Pramana, and Pratyaksha and Apratyaksha Pramana, all three are very important. This, since he believes in the Shabda Pramana, that itself shows that Sankhya is not an atheist, it's a theistic philosophy. Whereas they always used to say the Sankhya is Nastika, is not Nastika. Those who believe in the Vedas, they are called as the Astikas. So this itself shows that Sankhya Kapila was a Astika, not the Nastika. And he was talking about the Satkaryavada and Asatkaryavada, about this thing also, he has talked about it. And in the fifth chapter, he gives the detail about the Purva Pakshis, whatever they were talking about in that chapter, he gives. I'm not ready fully. So third chapter also are not read because
that's very good. That's very good.
Yeah. So this is what I could understand. Wonderful. Thank you. Yeah.
Please go ahead and study more. You will
have to read that one. And another is the second chapter is nothing comes from nothing, something from the something. So I always remember this sound of music. Yeah. Something comes from the something, sort of nothing. So that is very appropriate here.
Correct.
And another thing is that in the chapter,
I will have to cut here, Gauri. Let us give other people time too.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Welcome. Okay, who's going next?
Can I take Uttara?
Yes, please, Mala. Please put your video on, Mala.
Yeah. 1 minute. Yeah. Okay. It should come up. I don't know. Uttaraji, the first few days of the class, I didn't know what I was listening to. Everything was new. The nomenclatures, names, indriyas, I didn't know anything. But I'll be frank, it slowly started getting into me. But when that chapter with small stories came up, you know, that my mind just opened up and I could understand many things because analogies were drawn, similarities were drawn. And, you know, that was the time I took it from there.
Mm-hmm. It all cleared up.
Then, pardon me?
It all cleared up for you.
Yeah. Yeah. So it kind of cleared up and then it kind of became more interesting. I could go back and forth. I could understand the things like prakriti, primordial matter, indriyas, jnanendriyas. You guys were like very good at it, but I was just beginning. But after that chapter, you know, it kind of for me, it was like, hey, this is not something that is out of the world. It is something that is related to everyday stories. You know, that is how my interest just came out. And one thing that I have always asked you is and spoke about is I was intrigued was the topic of karma and deeds, how the phalas come, what happens, you know, when you have collected so many papa, so many punya, how do you go to the next family? I was intrigued, and even today, anything that I follow, anything that I study, anything that I do, I know that, well, you know, it's not going to go unforgotten. It's not going to go, you know, as unforgotten or, you know, though I don't do things earlier also, I never did things with the aim of getting respect, but I know aim of getting something in return. But today I know that
it is not
this exists.
Yeah.
Yeah. This exists and yeah, it won't get lost. Even a small thing will not get lost, you know.
Right.
And that thing also was new to me, which I kind of accepted completely, is which we have again spoken that it is not that you do 10 papas and 10 punyas, it kind of gets equalized. You know, there are different patrams for everything and that is how it is kind of distributed. Now, what in this, like, this is a complete from chapter one to chapter, you know, I learned many things, what I told you, but now in this chapter, I liked more about the joy and sorrow. I never knew that. I mean, I had not taken it that there is sorrow in happiness also. And this example you had given in one of the previous chapters. And you had used a very what to say, a down-to-earth example that I could understand. Like you had said that, you know, something as mundane, but it was so clear to me that you are so happy, you're trying, something to the effect like this, huh? That you're so happy, you're kind of cooking and, you know, you want to dish out for your children, make something new. But the sorrow is you have to wash the vessels later on, you know? I mean, that was something that it made me understand many things in that one small example, because again, I think I'm an analogy person. If you draw similarities, I kind of understand it better. I understand it quickly and all that. So coming to this, what I like, what I, apart from the karma, karma phala, what I discussed to you, this joy and sorrow is something that I really liked in this one. In between, I'm also trying to see, because my video...
I will have to
leave it.
Yeah, let me take the next person. But this is an important point that you have brought out, that the fourth chapter started making things clear for you. Maybe next time I take Sankhya, I must make sure that I bring in some analogies in the beginning itself, so that any person who is new can start relating quickly.
Yeah.
That is a good input.
I don't know about others. Probably everyone has learned other books, other, you know, shastras. But for me, this was kind of, this just opened up into the world, you know. Things started becoming very clear for me. I mean, I don't know about the others. Now, coming back to joy and sorrow.
Actually, Mala, she wanted you to be short because time is running out.
Yeah, yeah. 1 minute. You give me 1 minute.
Sure. Go ahead.
So that there are two types of happiness. One is, apart from, you know, there is sorrow in every happiness, you know, all that. There are two types of happiness. One is, and all the life, we all work towards achieving a final goal. And that is to removal of, you know, all sorrows. And that, and two types of happiness is, one is, you know, where did I wrote? Yeah. One is happiness in the world, and one is happiness in the other world. The yeah. One happiness in this world is, requires a lot of effort, but comparatively less effort than the one that we want to achieve in the other world, which is enormous effort. So, and yes. Then I also liked about, you know, the gunas, that how it is there in everything, every part of our life. It's kind of touching, you know, the sattva, raja and tamasic guna, and how the soul is disconnected and it remains unattached to sattva, raja and tamasic gunas.
Raja, yeah.
So, again, coming back, because you had given examples with everyday life, it kind of, I could understand it better. Like regarding sattva raja guna also, you gave examples. Joy, sorrow, you gave it. I think that is how it kind of got into me. Mm. And yes, you know, this sixth chapter, though I read quite a number of times, that it is kind of making me go and read to other chapters as many number of times, so that, you know, it has kind of pushed me into reading it more and understanding it better, you know, going back and forth. I like this whole thing. So this, you know, now I'm getting into that tension tea. I don't have time, but overall it was a very good class. Very good class.
I'm happy. I'm happy.
Good. Now Uttaraji.
Chalo, you must
I'm happy.
Revise more. Okay.
Yes. Yes. Though I have to say that I have to tell you this. Though there were a couple of Sanskrit words that I couldn't understand, because I never studied Sanskrit. So I used to go to this internet and Yogapedia and get the, you know, more.
with Anuja at home.
You have a dictionary with you.
There is a saying, no? The medicine in the backyard is not medicine.
Hey, come on, let me complete, you know, quickly.
Anyway,
quickly.
Please let's see, there are two more people who have to give feedback, Mala.
Are 1 minute. Uttaraji, one more thing. One more thing I was very happy is, though there were repeated words that, you know, came up in many sutras, many chapters, every time you made it a point to give the meaning in brackets. I thought that was, you know, so once you understand, you can just go back into, you know, where you had written it. And that's it. You know, things kind of get clear. I hope I'm clear on what I'm saying.
Yeah. That's wonderful. I'm happy.
Yeah. Thank you so much. So I, yeah, this is what I wanted to say. Yeah, Prashanti, whoever, you know, is ready, can take.
Yeah,
whoever.
Continue, Mala, continue with your studies. You will get more out of it, I'm sure.
Yes, I will.
Yes. Prashanti, you want to start now?
Sure. So the best, thank you, Uttaraji. I mean, ever indebted to you for the whole knowledge that you are, you know, giving to us. And there is so much to contemplate upon, and it's amazing, actually. So the class closes and we become very emotional. Okay.
True. For me also, I am going to miss all of you.
So I wish I was the first one, so I don't become emotional.
Yeah, you don't. You're not going to give us a long break, no.
So that the reason for being emotional is sutra doesn't take long break.
What is
really
it?
You know, ever grateful. Apart from that, and now that I am last, there is not much I should talk about any which way, because all my fellow learned scholars have already.
Let me repeat it.
No, Mr. Chandran, I don't think has given feedback either. So
he also has to come. That is true.
I have already written and got my replies.
So, of course, the very opening statement, like in the Yoga Darshanam, of course, in the Sankhya Darshanam also, the very opening statement itself is which you can contemplate your whole life and learn a lot, and, you know, probably will lead to the mukti itself. Mm-hmm. Then he has written a book on how to achieve that statement, and, you know, line by line guidelines towards the goal. So it was really amazing for, you know, amazing journey in as such. So not going into the details of the whole thing which already Divya covered, like how he has line by line has explained how the whole makeup of Srishti, Prakriti and everything, and the complex of mind, intellect and all that, he has discussed so beautifully that, you know, we can keep on reading it and understand the, you know, and dissect it and understand what is really important for us. The few things that have really, you know, every once in a while, I just, even without touching the Sankhya book, which I keep thinking is what I'm going to, discuss. So, statement of Nanitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Svabhavasya Tadyogastadyogadyate Yogadrute. That, you know, here basically telling the Svabhava of the soul. That it is eternal and it is the Shuddha, Buddha, and it is the Mukta. So, you know, that is a constant reminder for me, like what is the real identity of the soul and what actually the real identity of myself and what one should keep on contemplating upon. So that keeps on coming to my mind, and, you know, which kind of makes me read all the other, how I can come to that level of understanding about my own self. then of course the, you know, then by what is the bondage, why it has come, it, what is ignorance, and then he discussed very much in detail in sixth chapter also, you know, the reason for the bondage and how the ignorance comes with the bondage, and you know how the karma phala and the cyclic nature of it, etc. So that also gives me quite a bit of a thinking. And so the again the 20th, that Aviveka, he talks about in the 120 also. And then the rest, I think Divya has covered very well in about the first chapter, which I also concur with. And then going to the second chapter, here he says, Shravana Matra Tatsiddhiranadivasanaya Balavatvat. So the about contemplating and not just listening to the, you know, discourses and all that will never take you to moksha, but you know, over a period of contemplation and over a period of practice and thinking about it is what kind of makes you realize what is moksha all about. So that is also another thing, like, you know, I keep thinking about. So that should actually push me to read more, and which, as you know, I am not doing much, and just kind of more active in housework and duty, which is where I think when Kala was talking about all the ashrama duties and then take up sannyas and all. So one thing I think Kapila only gives the example of one sadhu who was a renunciate for a long period of time, but then when he sees the fishes in the Ganges, then all of a sudden he realizes he wants to have a family, etc., and goes marries the daughter of a king. So like that, with all the vasana still being here, I want to slowly leave the vasanas before I could even talk about bigger things. But you know, this book really helped me to slowly how to let go of the vasanas. And he talked quite a bit on the karma, you know, giving more importance to the karma, and because of which, you know, how we become subservient to the vasanas, and that has more servants, like, you know, our vasanas become hundredfold, and how we are into the, you know, rigmarole of this. So again, slowly understanding and contemplating on this Shuddha Nitya Buddha identity of one, slowly, you know, letting go of the desires and seeing their, you know, the very word you use always kind of makes me think, the ephemeral stand of all the material things, that is slowly, you know, definitely, you know, makes one let go of the ragas, etc., which is all the vrityas also slowly will go away, which he made a very good point, like why we are so tied with this bondage, because, you know, it's not just the vasanas but the hundreds of the servants that come with it also. So that was something again kind of impressed me, and slowly working on that as well. And then the 323, I'm opening 323, which was, 1 minute, let me, I can't quote, can't remember, I have to look at it.
Jnanan Mukti.
Jnanan Mukti, yes. So that was also, so yeah. Get as much knowledge as possible so you can, you know, let go of all these bondages, etc. That was also another you know, simple yet, you know, which keeps kind of nagging in your brain. So you work towards more jnanam also. And the 41 where he says, karma vaichitryat pradhana cheshta garbhadasavata.
Yeah.
So this also again reminds me of, you know, again in a way, like, it also makes me think of about the yoga darshanam, that jati ayu bhoga thing. So my here
karma phala already sets the motion of how I am going to be and it decides a quite a fair bit of it. So let me always work. So you know the cyclic way of life, where you know our current karma will always have an effect on it. With that, I have a great impact on, you know, always thinking about my activity, etc., and all that. So that was another important lesson for me. And 4-9 is...
I think we will have to leave it there, Prashanti.
Sure.
So obviously, you have been thinking and working a lot on it. And to help you progress further, I would say that daily prayer for everybody is most important. Please make it a daily habit. Okay, 1 or 2 days in a week, if you're not able to do, it is all right. But you must sit down for prayer separately in a quiet room. And you must try and do meditation also for a while, in which you just empty your mind of everything. Don't force yourself into something. The idea is to blank out your mind as much as possible. So in fact, in the beginning, you might go to sleep even. So you had seen in Yoga Darshanam, Patanjali said that even entering that sleepy state is good. So don't be worried about that. It's all right. You can even fall fully asleep in the beginning. It is not an issue. But you must try and practice meditation as much as possible. And you must, I have given you now a lot of things to chant. So please use those as prayer and sit for prayer. And before we are kicked out, let us finish with our prayer. Maybe we will come back again. Shall we continue? Shall I set up one more meeting?
And sure. I think we can come with the same link itself.
We can come. Yeah. So yeah. Let us do one thing. We'll just end it so that we don't do this in a hurry. I'll just end this and I'll set up with the same link. Okay.